On the plains of Masai Mara, the most important moment of the annual cycle is anxiously awaited. Each year, the land along the Mara River receives thousands of zebras and wildebeests who come here from the Serengeti on their endless pursuit of rain. But with global climate change, the rain cycle is more and more unpredictable. And this year, the water has arrived late. As a result, the wildebeests are still not here. Predators on the savanna are suffering. Migration means 1.5 million herbivores on the move. Prey that the hunters impatiently await on the shores of the Mara. There are buffalo here year-round, but a buffalo is much stronger than a wildebeest, and hunting one is an extremely risky use of precious energy. Hunger has made this crocodile act in haste. If the buffalo had gone further into the water, the croc might have had a chance. But when it comes to brute strength, few can beat the Cape buffalo. The lions are impatient as well. Food is more and more scarce, and the youngest members of the pride are willing to do whatever it takes for a bit of meat. A hippopotamus, sick and alone, wouldn't be of any importance to the young lions under normal circumstances. But hunger is a powerful force that wins out over fear. The lioness lets her cubs make a bid for the impossible. She is just as hungry as they are. If the wildebeests don't get here soon, the pride will be facing a serious problem. Any and all attempts for food will be risked. Our mother cheetah is also under pressure to feed her children. They are not dependent on wildebeests and zebras, animals which are too large for these high-speed hunters. But with so many other carnivores turning to the cheetah's natural prey, the competition is more and more fierce. A bit further on, hidden in the high grasses of the savanna, a caracal prowls in search of prey. This wildcat hunts birds and small rodents while trying to remain invisible to the other hunters. But this time, his efforts are in vain. One of the cubs spots the caracal, and his brothers quickly join him. Their mother recognizes the scent of the animal her cubs are following, and she decides to save her energy for something more nutritious and easier to catch. Experience tells her that caracals can be aggressive and dangerous, so she ignores it. Meanwhile, her attitude shows her offspring that they should abandon the hunt. While the cubs wrap things up, their mother spots a group of Thompson gazelles on the horizon. Her body changes in an instant, and the doting mother turns into the greatest predator on the savanna. The hunt begins. Immediately, the gazelles are on their guard, as though they have guessed the cheetah's location. In a moment of powerlessness, the female abandons the hunt. The cause of her failed ambush is clear. Just a few meters away, a group of tourists has left the trail without permission in an effort to photograph this animal they so admire and enjoy. What these nature lovers don't realize is that they have put the survival of this family in serious danger. When Europeans arrived on the African savanna, a profound change took place. The natives had already transformed the grasslands with fire and grazing, but the industrial development brought here by the colonialists would significantly alter the world of local wildlife forever. In the mid-20th century, things began to change. The same animals that had attracted hunters from all over the world began to prove that they could provide a different sort of income. A new kind of tourist simply wanted to observe the animals and enjoy being around wildlife. Several governments committed to the idea. As a result, an extraordinary industry grew up, offering incredible benefits, strengthening the development of local communities, and protecting area animals and ecosystems. In 2007, Kenya welcomed about 2 million wildlife lovers. This translated into approximately 616 million euros, or 12% of the country's gross national product. These numbers showed that the conservation of wildlife could be self-sustainable as long as tourism was kept under control. Since the time of English colonialism, Masai Mara has been the best known example of grasslands teeming with wild animals. So much so that in 1949, it was named a game preserve, ensuring its protection. The first lodge for tourists and hunters was built here in 1963. And since then, the number of hotels and campsites has taken off. The number of lodges has multiplied exponentially, with bigger and better facilities. Today, there are more than 30, and they are all connected using a network of dirt roads. Over the years, Masai Mara has become a bustling area which is crisscrossed daily by scores of vehicles. Still, the impact on the ecosystem within the reserve's 1,673 square kilometers wouldn't be significant if tourists would abide by the rules. But the rules were written with an understanding that visitors would be sensitive to the savanna's delicate balance, or in other words, that they would have some sort of environmental manners. But that seems to be too much to ask.